Welcome to the THP Online Community. I'm Pastor Dallas, Online Community Pastor. Before we get into today's message, I'd like to invite you to join our Facebook group, THP Online Community. THP Online Community is an extension of the ministry that takes place at the Healing Place in Shreveport, Louisiana. We believe that community is more than just a location. It is a culture defined by living for Jesus together. As such, we believe that through online platforms such as this, we can encourage others in their walk with God as they strive in being who God created them to be, knowing what He is saying and doing what He says. Today, you will be hearing part four of our series, Threads. This message you're about to hear from Pastor Scott is called Breakthrough to See Clearly. Because this message is part four of our series, we'd like to encourage you to go back and listen to the previous messages. We hope that this message not only ministers to you, but challenges you. We firmly believe that the things spoken here on Sundays and Wednesdays are not just for those who are able to join us, but also for members of our THP Online community.
All right, let's go to Genesis 38. Genesis 38. And we're going to get right into this. I know we've had a lot going on today. But as we have a lot going on today, there's not anything else that's more important than the Word of God. Everybody say amen. So I'm going to ask you just to stay with us here. I'm not going to take my liberty and just do whatever I want. I am aware of where we are in the schedule, but I'm also aware of the Word that God's given me today. And just in case you don't know, our staff and our team, when you guys go and eat, they're still here. Sunday's a work day for us. They're here counting. They're here doing different things. They're here shutting everything down. They're here cleaning stuff. We're going to be here, okay? So I want you to hang with me and get this word. I really feel like somebody's going to get some breakthrough today. And kids, I'm just going to tell you right off the top, this probably was not in your children's Bible. Parents are like, ugh. Listen, parents. Our parents hear and see worldly things, and we just go about life. And then we get in a church, and we got to get all sanitized, and we sanitize the gospel. And our kids grow up knowing more about the world and the mess and the debauchery of the world than they know about the true gospel of Jesus Christ. Everybody with me? Listen, I'm sick of the secular world teaching our kids about sex. The Bachelor and the Bachelorette, yeah, I called it out, should not be teaching our children about how to have relationships. Come on. Is that true or not? Now, if it's not true and you believe the Bachelor is better than the gospel, stay after and we can talk. Because I want to know where you're going to find it here. You say, well, that's clothesline preaching. I don't care what it is. The gospel is offensive. If you want to live the way the world lives, the gospel is offensive. It just is. And Jesus was offensive too. I know we all want to make Jesus out to be some hippie LSD taken peace, love, and Woodstock and all that. And by the way, Woodstock wasn't a peace movement. There was rape and violence and drug addiction and drug abuse and all manner of things that happened at Woodstock. So those of you boomers that are talking to your kids about Woodstock, you need to be talking to them about revival. Whew. Listen, if this is the last message I ever preach, I'm preaching it. If I drop off face map this afternoon, I'm giving it all I got right here. All right? Here's the title today, Breakthrough to See Clearly. How many of you need breakthrough today? Right? Breakthrough. Romans 8:28. We've been talking about threads and how God desires to use every single thread. And here's the scripture we've been reading. And we know, not we think, we know. And what do we know? We know that all things, everybody say all things. We know that all things work together for good. Well, you mean this one that I didn't like and this happened to me and it was bad? And this, yes, everything. The worst thing that happened to you, God wants to take it and use it for your good. Now that's good news, right? And we know that all things work together for good to who? To those who love God. So if you love God, you're already getting in front of the line. And to those who are the called according to his purpose. Those who have said, I don't just love God. He's not just Savior, but he's Lord. I'm taking up my cross and I'm following him. And if you have done those things, then you are right in line for God to use the worst event of your life. And now he will use it for your good and for his glory. Now that's good news, right? So we continue this thought process of threads. And we're going to see today how where sin runs deep, grace runs deeper. Can somebody say amen? We have a hard time seeing how God is going to use the tangled threads of our lives to create something beautiful. And all these tangled threads try to take us into a deep pit of self-pity, doubt, and fear. And that's all we see. Yet God takes every single one and it weaves it into a masterpiece. And let me tell you something. It's hard to see what God is doing when you're blind. It's hard to see what God is doing when you're blinded. And when we last left our dysfunctional family, we've been reading about some serious dysfunction with God's covenant people. When we last left this family, they had sold their brother Joseph into slavery, and it's been rough, but it's about to get worse. Because this family continues to put themselves in situations which look impossible for God to do anything. So what we are talking about today, again, kids, you won't find it in a children's Bible, all right? It's not necessarily rated PG. Some scholars believe, listen to me, some scholars believe it doesn't even belong here, not because of theology, but because they believe it interrupts Joseph's story. Let me tell you something. It's not just a story, it's real life. And real life is messy. And I know when we give our life to Jesus, we try to sanitize everything and make it look all rosy and all nice, and we want to erase our history. Listen, you can't erase your history. Through the blood of Jesus, you can erase the way you act and the way you behave. You can be a new creation in Christ Jesus and not be the same person, but you still got the same family, and you still sinned then, and you still blew it then. It's all still real. But if you give it to Jesus, it can all still be good. Right? Listen, without this thread, many just would skip over Genesis 38. Even in doing a message series. Genesis 37? Yeah. Let's go to 39. No. Because without 38, Jesus as the Lion of the tribe of Judah is stripped of its power. Because God strategically uses this disgusting thread. Yes, I said disgusting thread. For our eternal good and for his glory. Genesis chapter 38, verse 1. It came to pass at the time that Judah departed from his brothers and visited a certain Adullamite whose name was Hira. And Judah saw there a daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua, and he married her and went into her. He says when he went into her, they had relations together. Everybody understand that, right? Listen, if you're not explaining this to your kids, they're not getting it. Husbands and wives have relations. Does everybody understand that? Does everybody get that? And they're supposed to. Because God brought a man and a woman together under the covenant of marriage, and they are supposed to be one. Not just spiritually and emotionally, but even physically. Amen. Some of you are so nervous right now. You're just like, please, Pastor, don't say that. My daughter, my son. We should be. Oh, man, I just got to be very careful today. I want to be very, very, very careful today. So she conceived and bore a son. How does she conceive and bear a son? It's not through a stork. It's not through the Easter bunny or through Santa Claus. Right? Okay. Just making sure everybody's got this. Because sometimes we act like we haven't got this. So she conceived and bore a son, and he called his name Er. She conceived again and bore a son, and she called his name Onan. And she conceived yet again and bore a son and called his name Shelah. He was at Kezeb when she bore him. Then Judah took a wife for Er, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. Everybody say Tamar. But Er, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord killed him. Now this will mess you up. Right? And Judah then says to Onan, go in to your brother's wife and marry her and raise up an heir to your brother. So the brother dies, and now Judah says, listen, next in line, it's time for you to go, and it's your responsibility now. But Onan knew that the heir would not be his, and it came to pass when he went into his brother's wife, again, he had relations with his wife, that he omitted on the ground lest he should give an heir to his brother. So he had relations with her, but there was no conception. He stopped before that would happen. Why? Because he got greedy. Because he didn't want his brother to have the firstborn rights. He wanted the firstborn rights. Everybody good? Kids, you all right? All right. Awesome. And the thing which he did displeased the Lord. Therefore, he killed him also. Whew. I told you it was going to get worse. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house till my son Shelah is grown. For he said, lest he also die like his brothers. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. Now in the process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died. And Judah was comforted, and he went to his sheep shearers at Timnah, he and his friend Hira the Adullamite. And it was told Tamar, said, look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep. So she took off her widow's garment, covered herself with a veil, wrapped herself, and sat in an open place, which is on the way to Timnah. Which, by the way, when you do not know who you are and you've been hurt and you're insecure and all those things, you're going to try to be something you're not. For she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot because she had covered her face. So he doesn't know who she is. This is actually his daughter-in-law, but he doesn't know that because she's dressed up. Then he turned to her, by the way, and said, please let me come into you. What is he saying? Come to your house? No, relations. Everybody got it, right? For he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. So she said, what will you give me that you may come into me? And he said, I will send a young goat from the flock. So she said, will you give me a pledge till you send it? Let me tell you something. Sinfulness will not just cost you a goat, but it'll cost you a lot more. Then he said, what pledge shall I give you? So she said, listen, lust will take you from a goat to a signet ring. I said lust, not love. Kids, there's a difference between love and lust. Love is from the Lord. Lust is from the devil. That's straight gospel. Everybody with me? You kids with me? It's okay. You can shake your head. Yes, it's okay. I know it's a little weird, but it's okay. Huh? Good. I want to make them nervous. Because when you're nervous, you pay attention. Come on, somebody. Right? It's like, all right, what verse are we at? All right, 18, thank you. All right. Then he said, what pledge shall I give you? Your signet and your cord and your staff that is in your hand. Now it just is more and more and more and more. Then he gave them to her. The lust he has is so powerful that he gives away that which is most precious to him. Whew. Then he gave it to her, went into her, and she conceived by him. So now his daughter-in-law has his seed. So she arose and went away, laid aside her veil, and put on the garments of her widowhood. And Judah sent the young goat by the hand of his friend the Adullamite to receive his pledge from the woman's hand, but he did not find her. And then he asked the men of that place, saying, where is the harlot who is openly by the roadside? And they said, there was no harlot in the place. Woo, uh-oh. So he returned to Judah and said, I cannot find her. Also, the men of this place said, there was no harlot in this place. Then Judah said, let her take them for herself, lest we be shamed. Again, let her keep those things that are most valuable because I don't want people to know what I really did. Ooh, God. For I sent this young goat and you have not found her. And it came to pass after 3 months that Judah was told saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has played the harlot. The woman you slept with was your daughter-in-law. So what does that mean? Now he knows that she knew who he was. And he's about to be found out. Now this is Judah of the covenant family, right? He knows God maybe more than anybody on the planet. Furthermore, she is with child. Like, you didn't just sleep with your daughter-in-law. She's got a kid now. So Judah said, bring her out and let her be burned. Listen, when you start getting exposed for your sinfulness, you'll try to blame everybody else and you'll try to overdo it with everybody else because you don't want to be exposed. When she was brought out, she sent to her father-in-law saying, by the man to whom these belong, I am with child. And she said, please determine whose these are, the signet, the cord, and the staff. So what happens? She lays it all out on the ground and says, look, everybody knows who you are now. I may be getting burned at the stake, but everybody's going to know what you did. Whoo! Those things that are in secret, whispered in secret, will be shouted from the rooftops one day. So Judah acknowledged them and said, she has been more righteous than I. Boom, repentance. Because I did not give her to Shelah, my son, and he never knew her again. Listen, the more you study Genesis, the more you see how blinding sin is. Here's another member of God's family, blinded spiritually. Judah's name means praise, but this is not praiseworthy. After he sells Joseph, he makes friends with a Canaanite. The verb in verse 2 says that he saw her. Genesis 3, when it says that Eve saw, she took, she ate. In Genesis 6, it says the sons of God saw the daughters of men and they took. Genesis 34 says Shechem saw Dinah and took. In other words, this is lust at first sight. Seeing and taking in Genesis is defined as people being blinded by sin and doing what they want outside of God. Judah has 3 sons. Life is good. Tamar, a Canaanite girl, she's probably 14 or 15 at this time. Er was about the same, maybe 14, 15, but he's wicked. We're not told what he did that caused his death, but we know that he's gone. And then marital laws say if a husband dies without heir, his brother marries his widow and produces an heir, and the son would be given the name of the dead man. Heir. The son would be given that name. But Onan wants the firstborn rights for himself. He knows he's bound to duty, so he fakes it. Listen, this whole terminology of faking it until you make it, they even say that about church services. When the music hits it, just fake it until you make it. Let me tell you something. When you worship God, it is in spirit and truth. That is true worship. It's not faking it. You don't need to fake it until you make it. Don't raise your hands and try to fake it until you make it. Surrender to Jesus, and then it can all be real. Because true worship is spirit and truth. It's not faking it until you make it. Whew. Whew. Man, I'm tired. I may need a vitamin water or something before we get through with this thing. All right. So no one would know. But when you think no one knows, God sees it. And listen to me, it was not what he was doing, but it was why he was doing it. And his life is taken. Listen, we may see it as judgment, but if you read this, we see it as an intervention by the Lord. Judah is blind to it. He sends Tamar away and he promises his third son. Listen, you go away, and when he is old enough, when he grows up, I will give him to you. But here's the deal. Secretly, Judah believes that it's Tamar's fault that his sons are dying. And he doesn't want his third son to get with her because he might die too. And he was trying to blame Tamar for his son's wickedness. And that's a tough thing as a parent because we always want to be in defense of our children. Could somebody say amen? But sometimes when we take our eyes off the Lord and get our eyes on the situation and only our children, we can't see their own wickedness and we blame everybody else for their wickedness. Listen, if my girls were blowing it, yes, I checked to see if the teacher was doing what they should. Yes, I checked to see if the administration were doing what they should. But if my girls were, I didn't call everybody else wicked. I called wicked, wicked. And in my house, we're not having it. Now, some people, when they hear me, if they don't know me, they would think, my Lord, he just beat his kids all the time. If you go to Sierra and Lizzie today and go, hey, how many times did your dad whip you? They can't hardly remember when it happened. Listen, I know y'all think I'm all intense and I'm... She tore them up. In 2018, she is in jail. The wooden spoon is out of the purse, man, at Brookshire's. It's like if you even grab anything on that shelf and put in this buggy, shwack. We ain't waiting until dad gets home. And then I come home, and then they think I'm about to just take a flamethrower to the whole house. And I come home, and I'm like, what happened? And she's like, well, they did this, and I gave them the spoon. And I said, well, they don't need anything from me then. But listen to me. I sure went into that room, and I looked those girls right in the eye, and I said, if you ever disrespect your mama again, listen to me, and in my house, listen to me, in my house, lying, we don't have any problem with failure in our house. If you own it. But if you lie and you disrespect adults who are trying to teach you, we are not just going to have a talk. Listen, I didn't have a wooden spoon because here's what I knew. I knew that I got beat with everything you could possibly get your hands on. I got beat with skillets. I got beat with wrought iron. I got beat with a Electrolux aluminum metal extension. That's abuse. Listen to me. When you go to bruising and blood, that's abuse. Come on, somebody. Right? So our generation, we knew about abuse. Listen, abuse, punishment is not discipline. Punishment is punishment. Discipline is correction. Right? Discipline is, I love you so much, I'm not going to let you go down that road. Let's auto-correct right here. And so for me, it was this right here. We'd go in the room. And listen, I'm telling you this for a reason. We'd go in the room, and I would sit down, and I would say, assume the position. And they would lean over my legs. Yeah, oh, they're already crying. They're already doing that. But listen, I didn't do what my folks did. My folks would be like, if you don't shut up, you're going to get some more. I'm like, you just beat me. I'm going to cry. Bend over, bang, bang, bang. They'd want to get out and go. I'd be like, uh-uh, sit in my lap. Ooh, that's the worst right there. Sit in my lap, look me in the eye. Oh. And then I would say, you know what? I love you. And here's why this just happened. And there's nothing in me that wanted to do this. But I have to so that you will learn a lesson. Right? And then I would hug them and I would love on them and I would go, let's pray. Now, some people would go, well, they ain't going to like prayer because you did this. I don't care if they like it or not. But they're going to hear my words of blessing come out of my mouth in their ear when they've been corrected. Because I want them to understand that God is a loving God and God loves them as a loving father. But there are going to be times that God's going to say, assume the position. And he's going to spank their rear end. And you know what he's going to do? He's going to say, he's not going to say, go your way. He's going to say, get in my lap. And he's going to say, I love you. And I bless you, and I gave my son for you. Come on, right? Listen, we have got things so twisted and so out of whack, and Judah's looking for everybody else to be blamed for his son's own wickedness. But here's what he forgot. He was actually the one who was responsible for this woman. He was blind, and this was injustice. And so then Judah's wife dies. So Tamar dresses like a prostitute, and we're told that this time frame may be like a week and a half, maybe even 2 weeks at the most. He's only been without his wife for about 10 days, and lust is already getting a hold of him. That tells you right now the dude just is not in line with God. So what does she do? She's like, fine, if I'm not getting Shelah, I get it. It's been too long now. He's not ever going to give me that kid. So I'm taking matters into my own hand. I'm going to get justice. So she dresses like a prostitute. And she's after justice. And here's this lusting man. And he can't wait. He can't wait. His lust can't wait. But I can tell you this, he sure could wait in taking care of his daughter-in-law. So Judah gives away his signet, basically his license and his social security number. Here you go. Not just a goat, but here's my license and here's my social security number. Here's my passwords to my bank account. Here's my password to my 401k. Here's my password. He gave it all to her. For what? One moment. One moment. And the one moment almost cost him. Not just him personally, but his whole family. So he gives it away. Why is he giving her something so valuable? Because he's blinded. Listen, it's sin. You pay a lot more than you get in return. Judah doesn't see what he's doing. He's failed as a father, a brother, a son, a father-in-law. So now he wants his stuff back. He sends the goat, keeping his obligation to a prostitute, but not keeping his obligation to his daughter-in-law. And when the supposed prostitute could not be found, he's like, okay, just let it go, because if we search into this, everybody else is going to know and I'm in real trouble. So 3 months later, Judah's told Tamar's pregnant, here he comes. And he begins to condemn her for crimes he's committed himself. That's what we call a hypocrite. He's blind. And the punishment for her actually is stoning. But he believes that she's guilty of the death of his sons. So what does he do? Let's burn her to death. What does he do? He goes overboard. Why? Because he doesn't want his own sin to be found out. And burning to death was reserved for the most despicable crime. It's not just death, it's torture and death. And he's trying to torture her to feel better about his own sin. Listen, do we do that sometimes? We see everyone else. Listen, I have people come to me all the time, and they're like, well, so-and-so did this, and so-and-so did that. And one of the first things I say is, have you ever done that? Because almost always, the answer is yes. Well, so-and-so lied about me and they lied on me. Have you ever lied about somebody? Yeah. Did you go to that person and make it right? Did you ask forgiveness? Most of the time, the answer is no. But yet we want someone else to do that which we're not willing to do ourselves. See, that's the nature of sin. And so Judah is part of this covenant family. Again, he knows more about God than maybe anybody else on the planet. And we are no different. We can be blinded to our own sin. We have this need, this inner need to justify ourselves and to shift the blame. And we work hard. Listen to me. It is so tiring. Everybody hear me. It is so tiring to try to protect your own heart from the reality of how wrong, bad, and proud you are. It's hard work. Listen to me. It's hard work to lie. Because you begin to forget what you lied about and what you told the truth about. It's hard work. It's hard work to be a drug addict. It's not freedom. It's hard work. It's hard work to be a drunk. Why? Because there is no truth. It's all just a web of deceit, trying to stay away from, look, I don't really want to deal with who I really am. And Judah's going through all this stuff. You know, it's not me. It's my parents. It's my spouse. I couldn't help it. This. And as Tamar's being dragged to the fire, she takes out his possessions and the possessions scream to Judah. Do you see what you have done? He thought she was the issue, and it turns out he is the issue. Verse 26 says, Judah acknowledged them. What does that mean? He sees them. He was blind before, now he sees them. Tamar was not a curse, she was a blessing. And so Judah will go on, Genesis 44, he will go on, he will return to his brother, he will take care of his father, he will offer himself to Joseph for Benjamin's freedom. I mean, the dude is different. When he was exposed and he took it on personally, boom, transformation, Judah's different. Listen, our sins look small to us. Every sin says this, I'll just hide out over here in the corner. I won't hurt you. And so we tolerate it. Listen, I'm not a workaholic. I'm just productive. I'm not bitter. I'm justified in my anger. I'm not greedy. I'm blessed. I'm not a glutton. I just love food. Listen, some of us will go to lunch today and we'll be eating food and we'll be talking about food while we're eating. We will be watching a food program while we are eating. We say, oh, I'm not critical, I'm just discerning. I'm not angry, I'm prophetic. Listen, God helps us to see. And you know who he uses? He uses the Tamars. The difficulties in our lives. He uses those things so that we can see. And then we have an understanding. God, I need a breakthrough of grace. And here's the breakthrough of grace right here. Verse 27. Everybody okay? All right. Now it came to pass at the time for giving birth that, behold, twins were in her womb. And so it was when she was giving birth that the one put out his hand. Listen, just because you put out your hand first don't mean you're going to be first. That's a good word right there. And the midwife took a scarlet thread and bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. Then it happened, as he drew back his hand, that his brother came out. His brother was like, your hand got out, but I'm all the way out. I don't care if you got a thread on your wrist or not. I got arms and legs and my head and my eyes. Everybody's seeing me. I'm first. How many of you have a brother or sister like that? So here's the deal. His brother comes out unexpectedly, and here's what the midwife said. How did he break through? This breach be upon you. Therefore, his name was called Perez, which means breakthrough. Afterward, his brother came out who had the scarlet thread on his hand, and his name was called Zerah. So here come the twins. One hand out should have been the oldest. Midwife puts a thread on it, and all of a sudden the other one, boom, breaks through. The second becomes first. Aren't you glad? And when God came after you, there may have been a lot of firsts, but even though you were second, you had an opportunity to be first. Listen, God is doing things we cannot predict. It's Abel, not Cain. It's Isaac, not Ishmael. It's Jacob, not Esau. And what is God saying? God is saying, I will accomplish my plan with or without you. Like, my plan will come forth, even out of disobedience, which is a great word for us. Even if we're being disobedient to the Lord, if we will give it to him, he will use it. Aren't you glad that he's not just going to kill us? Listen, I wrestle with those words when it's like, oh, he did this. God killed him. I'm like, whew. Like, what am I doing right now? Right? And here's what happens. Judah had lost two sons, yet God gives him two more. And Tamar, who was abandoned, will now be taken care of for the rest of her life by her sons. When Judah wouldn't, God gave her two who would. She would have only had she would have only had Onan individually. Now she's got two, and they are bound now to take care of mama the rest of their life. God broke through. And we need to see our sin, but we need a breakthrough of God's grace. Listen, Judah had no idea what God was going to do or what he would do. Centuries later, a son from this family breaks through, and he would be called the first and the last. Matthew 1, Judah, Tamar, Perez, Zerah, all in the line of Jesus. First woman mentioned in the New Testament is not Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, Leah. But all of a sudden you start hearing Canaanite names. Tamar, she's in the bloodline. Bloodline of Jesus, Rahab, Jericho prostitute. Canaanite, Ruth, heathen, Moabite. Bathsheba, adulterous wife of a Hittite. Canaanites, Hittites, Moabites, the worst. And Jesus enters the world through these tangled threads. And then Revelation 5 crowns him with a heavenly name. What's that name? Lion of the tribe of what? Judah. It never gets changed. Well, man, didn't Judah do all those horrible things? He did. But Jesus is still called the the lion of the tribe of Judah. God used the Judah thread to declare his awesomeness. Amen. Stand up. I want you to put down your devices, your Bibles, everything else, and I want you to focus on the Lord. And I just have a couple of questions for you. Is it easier for you to see the sinfulness of others rather than your own? Maybe you see your own sinfulness today, but you need to get out of the shadows. You need to get that sin out of the corner. And you need a breakthrough of God's grace. Maybe God has laid your stuff out in front of you like Judah, and there is no more hiding today. It's not someone else. It's me, Lord. It's not Tamar, Lord. It's me. Listen, if he's only Savior, the tapestry of your life will never be complete. But if he is Lord, if he is Lord, if he is Lord, then every thread, good, bad, and ugly, will be used for your good and for God's glory. So if you need a breakthrough of grace, I want you to come down to the front right now. We're not going to waste any time on this. If you need a breakthrough of God's grace, God has spoken to you through this message. You need a breakthrough of God's grace. I want you to come right now. Come. It may be the 47,000th time you've come. It may be the first time you've come. But if you need a breakthrough of grace, I want you to come right now. Right now. You need prayer in this place? Come right now. If you don't, that's cool. That's fine. I'm not here to judge you. That's you and God. That's you and God. God didn't call me to convict anybody. God didn't call me to judge anybody. God didn't call me to do any of those other things. God simply said, this is the word, give it. And they will do with it what they want. All right? Holy Spirit, speak to every single one of us, not just those of us that have walked forward, step forward. But Holy Spirit, speak to every single person in this place right now. Lord, if there's anyone in this place that has given themselves over to lust, I pray that you would speak clearly to their heart. Anyone in this place, Holy Spirit, that has been bound by that thought process of lust, whether it be for greed or sexuality or power or whatever it may be, God, you would just reveal it right now. Reveal it. You don't reveal it to humiliate, you reveal it to heal. And I pray not one person in this room would walk out of this place today with lust, perversion, lying, generational curses, any of those things, would not walk off this property today without taking care of it with you, Jesus. Lord, we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ in this place. We are not ashamed to preach the gospel. We are not ashamed to declare the gospel. We are not ashamed. You said that if we would be ashamed of you, if we wouldn't be vocal about you, if we wouldn't declare you before men, you would deny us before the Father. So, Lord, we are not ashamed. The Healing Place is not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're not ashamed of the cross. For in the cross lies the power. In the resurrection lies the power. Power to be forgiven. Power to live in freedom. You are a resurrected Christ. You are not a dead God. You are very much alive today. And Lord, we prayed this morning at 9:30. You heard our prayers. Lord, help us to be audacious. That we would have the audacity not to just pray an impossible prayer as a request, but to declare the impossible. Declare that you are the God of the impossible. That we would have the audacity not just to ask, but to speak and declare it. So, Lord, I ask that you would just give that to every person in this room right now. I want a couple of guys to come up here real quick. Get behind these guys real quick. Come. I want everybody in this place, please, just pray. Just be praying right now. Listen, if we're praying, we're not simply doing nothing. We are doing something as we pray. Holy Spirit, I declare breakthrough right now. Breakthrough. A breakthrough of your grace, Jesus. A breakthrough of your grace, Jesus. A breakthrough of your grace, Jesus. A breakthrough of your grace, just like that came, Lord God, for Judah. A breakthrough of your grace, not just a revealing of what's in front of them, but God, a breakthrough of your grace right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. A breakthrough of grace.
Thank you so much for taking time to listen to this portion of our series, Threads. For more information about The Healing Place, please visit our website, www.thpshreveport.com. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram by simply looking for THP Shreveport. Our desire is for people to be who God created them to be, to know what God is saying, and to do what God says. If we can pray for you in any way, feel free to contact us via social media or by sending an email to mediahub@thpshreveport.com. Thank you for being part of the online community of The Healing Place.